For sure.
In order for the bench or the push press and the jerk to be an overloading exercise, you need sufficient load, obviously. And so now we're talking about time, cost to benefit ratio in regards to the time that you spend teaching them, and then the time it takes to for them to work up to a load that's actually sufficient to give them a stimulus. So you're balancing the time that it takes to get to that load with the execution of the lift. So my question to you, Marco, is how much does technique and just the eye test, like the form of the movement, the execution of the movement, matter in regards to a push press or a push jerk? If it looks a little sloppy, but they're still getting the dip and the power output, can we live with that? I guess is my point.
Yeah, that's a tricky question, actually. Well, especially under heavy loading conditions and for the split jerk, I would say, like the heaviest one, it's gonna be very important, the technical efficiency. But well, look, for this, we have just done a study on the 1 RM performance, not kinetics and kinematics, 1 RM performance on the push press, push jerk, split jerk across crossfitters and weightlifters. What we found, both population, they are like they've got used to train with this kind of exercise, so they've got a weightlifting experience. But the weightlifters, they differentiate especially at the split jerk, because it's the most technical exercise. However, the CrossFitters, they don't differentiate between the push jerk and split jerk. It means they lift similar loads using the push jerk or the split jerks. I think it is because when they do, for example, Grace or any of these workouts, 30 clean and jerk, they don't do a split jerk, so they do a push jerk. And that's why, for I would say, training specialization in these ways, it differentiates a lot between a sport. In my opinion, for targeting, like the lower body triple extension, if my goal is to increase the power production for my athletes, the push press, push jerk, split jerk, just targeting like the deep, as you said, like a good propulsion phase. If you don't have like a perfect technique, or maybe you take the bar overhead, like with the elbows a little bit flexed or something like that, it could be enough. So we are not weightlifting judges, so I could say so. But especially for weightlifters, you can see like the differences. But these differences are based on many, many, many years of training and many repetitions. And you can't get that with general sporting population, and it's not your target. They don't have to lift as a weightlifter because they are not.
I asked the question mostly because it's the most common one that I receive regarding using the weightlifting movements in any capacity, clean, snatches, jerks, for sports performance. It's the time that it takes to coach it. It's that cost benefit. And if you're a university, and I get that, I totally get that, and you can get similar power and force by just doing pulls. As far as lower body production goes, just doing the pull instead of doing the full clean or the full snatch. But it also doesn't take that long if you're still training other things. It's not as if it's picking these variations or nothing, and now you're going to spend like all that time while you're training to get good at the push press or good enough at it that you're not going to be training anything else. You're still can still do traditional things. If you've got an athlete for 4 years at a university, there's plenty of time. You start them their freshman year, learning the positions under very light loads, attaining a technique that's proficient enough to be able to sustain higher loads as they get better at it. But you've got all that time in the world. And I would still say if you've got a summer with an athlete, that's probably still plenty of time, even if I have zero experience with this stuff, to get them doing the movements with a load that's sufficient enough to create some type of stimulus while you're still getting them strong. That's my thought on it. It doesn't mean that you have to have them in there. It just means that the time thing, unless you're literally only seeing this athlete for a week, yeah, sure. You don't need to, there's not enough time. It wouldn't matter. But generally, our time periods, I think, are adequate enough. What do you think about that, John? And
I think
Jared,
there's
too.
two. I think there's two aspects to that. I think the first one is I think you have enough time as long as you don't allow the weight room ego to jump too much. You see, you mentioned getting stabilized technique. To manage that and manage the loads and make sure the lifts are still successful with that overload, and then also. Not having, I think a lot of coaches when they look at any movement really, and we can go into powerlifting with this as well, or any type of exercise, they look for this perfect thing, and if it's not perfect, then they don't allow it to be trained either. So there's a fine line of like, what can I get stimulus with, and what they can continue to learn and sustain, right? And then what's too much, right? Because we have this guise of perfection. So I think there is plenty of time. You just have to be diligent with it and allow them to practice and allow them to explore a little bit. And if you've got 4 years in a university setting, that's a lot of time.
Yeah, that's not even, that's
Yeah, it's
for
a
any.
lot of time. I mean, yeah, I've taken kids over a summer and gotten them proficient enough that the next summer they come back and they've done it enough and they look really good.
Yeah,
I see
my
your point.
sorry.
Oh, sorry.
I was
No, no,
just gonna say, I was just gonna say that my thoughts echo what you said, John. I think that there's plenty of time, and that if we have an understanding that we don't need things to be perfect according to these preconceived standards that most coaches are going to have in their heads, then it can be a very viable and useful strategy, to improve the performance that we actually care about.
and we talked even just in the beginning, there's going to be some variability in execution. We talked about the longer force development and the shorter first. Like, you got to allow that stuff to come to the forefront. Marco, what were you going to say, buddy?
Yeah, I see your point, and I could add that, as you said, there are some exercises, and Sukumal saw that, for example, the jump stroke, the hang high pull, and these kind of exercises, you can learn the technique just in a couple of hours. You don't need more than that. So you can start targeting these exercises, knowing that your objective is to improve maybe the power production. Then you can work on some more technical aspects, right? To progress, right? To target or to overload maybe a more difficult technique. So if you know how to do it, you can always program. You can always program it. And I would say, and I would like to add, because I did a conference about this in Spain, like 1 week ago or 2 weeks ago. And I said that the main problem, for example, in my country is that if the coaches themselves, we don't know how to perform these exercises. So many Tyson can tell you that these exercises are not teach because we don't know how to do them. And if we don't know how to do them, how can we transfer that knowledge to our athletes? So in my opinion, there is something that it's really important that apart that you know the theory, you have to train them, and you have to train how is the process of learning and not developing the same process that you do with yourself to your athletes. But you have to know what does it feel, how do you fail a power clean. And you need to know how is the feeling when you fail a power jerk. And you need to know how is the feeling when you fail a jump squat with 150 kg on your shoulders. Better you than your athlete, because that's your work. I think that's our work.
My thought, as John and Jared were talking too, and then you basically just reiterated it, is I think we're just scared to go overhead. In general, there's a little bit of a stigma there where it's we just don't want to go there. Got to be careful with overhead training. Got to be careful with overhead training. You see it with baseball players a lot. At least here, I see it where these high school coaches and college coaches, some of them are saying in the summer that don't train overhead. These kids will come into our gym and they'll train with us in the summer, and they'll tell us that their coaches don't want them going overhead. And again, it's about dosage and these types of things, but I would say that would it not create some, risk reduction if your shoulders are just strong in multiple planes? I would say, especially for a throwing athlete, those velocities are crazy high, and the arm is, it's not straight overhead, but it's out there and it's up there a little bit, So I don't get the inherent fear, and maybe it is coming from exactly what you just said, Marco, which is the coaches don't understand the movement themselves, and so they don't prescribe it, which I guess is fair to some degree, but maybe we just need to start getting back to training ourselves. Do you see?
Well, and there's
go ahead,
sorry. Tom. There's another aspect, the neuromuscular control that. We're talking about force development and that sort of thing, but a long-term benefit of high complexity movement is just greater degrees of freedom in other high complexity movements. If you start teaching a kid as a freshman how to do cleans and like you said, hang cleans that you can do, hang power clean you can teach in an afternoon, and you can develop that over a length of time to create a really high complex exercise, that will have neuromuscular control benefits later on down the road. And it might not be completely applicable across all field settings, but it at least can help with those degrees of freedom. Mile off base.
It gives them options, right?
Well, yeah, it gives you more options.
I agree.
If you're using the gym for specificity, then you're missing the boat. I don't care what you're doing, because the weight room is not specific to your sport. It's what you said, John.